Ever been in a supermarket and wondered how the food actually got there? If so, you're not alone. Consumers are increasingly questioning the origins of their food, and it's shaping their choices around who they shop with. New research shows that while 87% of shoppers are more likely to purchase products that are sustainably produced, only 41% are willing to pay a premium for ethically sourced goods. So, does consumer intent match the reality? Or are we forced to trade off ethics for cost when wanting to shop sustainably? Welcome to The Business of Food, part of the Business Of podcast series, brought to you by the Australian Graduate School of Management at the UNSW Business School. In this episode, we'll explore how the food industry is responding to the sustainable food movement. We'll unpack the challenges and opportunities facing both retailers and consumers and ask how technology will improve the way we shop. Professor Nick Wailes, Senior Deputy Dean and Director at AGSM, is joined in conversation by Tristan Harris, Co-CEO of Harris Farm Markets. We'll learn how Harris Farm is tackling important issues like food wastage with their Imperfect Picks fruit and veg boxes, and how the supermarket led the move away from single-use packaging in Australia. We'll also hear from Nitika Garg, Associate Professor of Marketing at UNSW Business School, an expert on consumer behaviour trends and the emotions that drive them. So grab yourself a snack and enjoy listening.
Welcome, Tristan Harris, CEO of Harris Farm Markets. Great to have you here. Tristan, just to start off, you could tell us a little bit about the business and what a day in the life of the CEO in the business of food is like.
Sure. Well, business Harris Farm Markets was started in 1971 by my dad, David Harris, and ably assisted by my mum, Kathy Harris. And they had planned on a different kind of business, but then circumstances all changed and they ended up buying a fruit shop. And from that fruit shop, they grew it through the 80s and then went through some really tough times and it got shrunk right back down to a single store. And then so we started regrowing from about 91 through to the present day. So that's been two cycles, one 20-year cycle, one 30-year cycle, and the business is now up to 27 stores. We've just opened in Queensland, and we're in a bit of a spurt. We had a change of strategy through from about 2013 through to the current period, and that's been a period of changing out our stores and realigning where we sold product and what product we sold, and now we're really starting to ramp up our growth plans again. Day in the life of a food CEO. I'm in quite an unusual position in that I share my role with two of my brothers. So we've got a three-way co-CEOship, which is quite an unusual leadership model. But it means that each of us can spend a little bit more time looking externally, engaging externally and looking for inspiration and ideas externally. We can also spend more time operationally, getting down and getting our hands dirty and getting in the detail, which if there were just one of us, we would not have literally the physical time to be able to do. So I spend a lot of my time in buying and marketing areas of the business and touch into IT and the wholesale sides of the business in a more significant way than I do for the parts of the business that my brothers run, such as the retail operations or the people and culture or the online business or finance.
So it's almost a perfect model having three genetically linked CEOs so you can be in three places at once.
Yeah. You know, I'm sure most people who've got siblings would say, I could never work with my brother/sister. I would also say I could never work with my two brothers. I do. We get it done. But it can be challenging, but it can also be very, very effective and very rewarding.
Today, we're going to talk about sustainability and how that's influencing the business of food. And I'm really interested in one of your initiatives, this Imperfect Picks initiative. And maybe you can just talk us through where that came from and how it's been for your organization and what you learned from it.
Yeah, sure. So retail industry is very good at what we call R&D, which is not research and design, but rip off and duplicate. And everybody does it in retail. And an old saying is there's nothing new in retail. We had always sold fruit that met this kind of criteria, some older listeners might remember, we used to have a table in each store with buckets on it, and each bucket had about a kilo of fruit in it, and we sold it by the bucket. So $2 for a bucket of apples, for example. And this was fruit that was not quite sort of making the grade for supermarkets. And so people would find an outlet for it at some of the markets, an outlet for it in some of the food service, or if they couldn't find enough of an outlet for it, it would get dumped. And a lot of food was getting dumped, sort of 20% of what's grown in Australia, approximately, according to Horticulture Australia, is getting thrown out. Then a supermarket over in France, Intermarché, ran a program called Legumes Moche, I think it was, so ugly vegetables, and said, we're going to address this problem by selling this product. And as soon as we saw it, we're like, wow, that's bold, but it's brilliant, and it's exactly what we do. And so we repackaged our program, called it Imperfect Picks, and really went out hard chasing growers and suppliers and said, there's a lot of stuff that we know is being chucked out. We won't be able to get you full price for it, but we think there's a lot of demand for this kind of product. And it was an enormous success. From the moment we launched it, people absolutely loved it. I think in the demographics that we serve, there is definitely a desire. Our consumers want to live according to their values and can afford to live according to their values more than just, I want to get something cheap. I mean, the biggest issue with food waste is not actually the sort of disappointment of wasting good food. It's that there is all of the inputs that are required to produce that food are still required. So we're producing a bucket load of carbon and pumping that in the atmosphere just to produce food that's thrown back into the ground. Now, that is unacceptable. And by finding a way to create a market for that food, customers loved that and engaged with it very heavily. And the benefit for them was that they got to pay half price.
So you've had this amazing response from customers, and it also makes your competition catch on pretty quick as well. Does that for you show a really significant shift in the way that customers are thinking about sustainability and the impact of their purchasing when they come into your shops?
Absolutely. I think we're all going too slow, but I think everybody is becoming more and more aware of their personal responsibility, given that there is a failure at the government level, at the global government level, to do enough to address some of the very significant challenges we're facing. And people are more and more recognizing that they're going to have to change themselves, because if we all just wait, we're going to be in so much trouble. It's going to hurt everyone a lot more by waiting. And I think the beauty of that is the more people that change before the governments get their act together, the easier it is for them to get their act together. So it's much easier to say, let's sort of put a rule in place that kind of reflects what everyone's already doing, or the majority of people are already doing. That way, we just bring the laggards across.
It's always good to have the consumer ahead of you asking for it. But I think for you guys, that can create some complexity, right? I imagine you get a lot of emails and a lot of comments about packaging, but it's quite hard for a consumer to know what the best type of outcome is.
Yeah, it is. We do, you're right. We get a ton of emails about packaging, and almost no emails about, what's the carbon footprint of the product that I'm eating. And packaging's one of those funny things. If you took all the packaging away, food waste would go through the roof. And packaging's actually incredibly necessary in our current food system to ensure that we don't waste a lot of food. And if we wasted a lot of food, we'd be pumping a lot more carbon in the atmosphere. So packaging's actually probably, well, in our view, our sustainability pipeline is focused much more on what we're going to do about addressing carbon footprint than what we're going to do about addressing packaging. But it's not the one that has the loudest share of voice at the moment with consumers. People hate plastic, and for good reason, but in our view, it can be a little bit of a distraction from the main game of addressing carbon.
So talk to me about educating customers around those type of things. How do you do that? How do you tell them the story about where the food comes from?
I think a really great way to do it is to do something very smart, like what Intermarché did and what we did, I think, very well in Australia, is create a campaign which says, hey, look at this. We've been doing something silly, and here's a solution which makes a lot of sense. And you offer up that solution. If you're offering up the solution at the same time as highlighting the problem, then it's a much easier sort of message to get across to people. If you just sort of put up your hand and say, hey, here's a problem. It's not compelling viewing. It doesn't get shared around as much. It doesn't get as much engagement from the customer. By working really hard to create solutions and then creating a campaign around a solution which is already addressing the problem, that's a very strong way to get consumer acceptance.
A couple of years ago, you moved away from single-use plastic bags. That must have been one of the moments where you really had to change the conversation you had with customers. How did you handle that and how did it work out?
So about 7 years ago, we really wanted to do it and we were really concerned about the impact that it would have if we just took bags away. And so rather than sort of being forcing customers into the position, we went out and said, what we'll do is we'll offer, if you don't use a bag for whatever reason, if you buy one product, if you buy 50 products, if you don't use plastic bags, we'll donate 5 cents to Clean Up Australia. That was much more expensive for us than the bag. But then we also made sure that we had a ton of our, you know, old fruit boxes and stuff like that sitting there near the registers for people to be able to say, okay, I don't need a bag because I'll just grab this box. And that was great. And we reduced our bag usage by a long way. We came out as the first major retailer in Australia to come out and say, all right, we're getting rid of plastic bags altogether. Well, we were the first ones to actually do it. And we just replaced them with paper bags. And again, that was a matter of just providing the solution. Everyone kind of knew the problem, but nobody really sort of wanted to touch the solution. I mean, a plastic bag, an HDP plastic bag was costing us about a third of a cent. And when we first did paper bags, they were costing us about 18 cents. And we go through a lot of bags. There's lots of customers and it's millions of bags a year. So millions of bags times 20 cents makes for a huge problem. And that's why the industry had chosen not to do it up until that stage. But when we were getting to sort of fever pitch about people on plastic bags and we had been trying very hard up until that point to get rid of them. And then this was just our opportunity to switch the whole game. And our total bag usage dropped by 90-odd% when we did it. So it wasn't as expensive as we were worried that it would have been. But definitely by providing the solution to the customer at our cost, not theirs, our customers, again, loved that. Whereas some of the other retailers just took the bags away and said, now you've got to buy bags for, 10 cents. And there was a lot of people that were very displeased when that happened.
So that's sort of getting out ahead of the issue and taking your opportunities when the time comes. I'm wondering, my impression is that an increasing number of consumers are concerned about the environment and sustainability of their actions, and it's shaping their choices when they're making purchasing decisions or who they shop with. How much do you take that into account when you're making decisions?
Absolutely. I mean, for us, our customer set is a pretty specific set of customers. There was some research done by Dr. Russ Honeywell, and he did a big study across three different countries and showed that there is basically two types of consumers. One is what they call NEOs, New Economic Order. Another is traditionals. And traditionals care about price, quality, status, very basic drivers. And it's the vast majority of the population. NEOs focus on all sorts of things that are important to them and to what they value. So again, things like sustainability, things like design, things like unique interactions and experiences, and they are our target customer. And so we spend a lot of our time trying to design what we're going to make our stores about, the products we're going to sell, the experiences that you have in the store, and the branding and market position that we want to put into market. We spend our time thinking about what's going to work for those people. And less, as a result, we spend less and less of our time trying to promote price credentials. I mean, you've got to be in, everybody likes to pay as little as they have to pay, but we spend less of our time thinking about how do we promote our price credentials and much more about what is our customer, our target customer, what do they actually want? And they actually want things that are authentic and real. And when there's a problem, they want it actually solved. They don't want some greenwashing. But if you then deliver that to them, they will reward you handsomely with their loyalty. And they won't be as price sensitive because they know that those things actually do cost money.
That's really interesting. You're in a position where you've carved out a group of customers that allows you to think about sustainability and to build that into your business. It's So we've been mainly talking about the shop experience and what customers see happening. But I'm really interested in other parts of your business and really the supply chain, because it seems to me that challenges of the supply chain is where sustainability really sits. From your point of view, what are the pet challenges of making your supply chain more sustainable or being able to carry that sustainability through all the way through your business?
The first thing I want to do is disagree with you that the food business is not all about the supply chain. I think the supermarket industry has made it all about the supply chain. And that's because what they are doing is focusing on keeping their costs down so that they compete with somebody else that does exactly the same thing as them. So the only way to compete with that is to make sure that your supply chain is better than their supply chain so that you can put it on shelf at a lower price. I think what is lost in that is the customer. And the customer, well, a certain set of the customers. Some customers, that's exactly what they do want. They want you to do that so that they get good quality food at the lowest possible price. Our set of customers don't necessarily want that. But you're right, the supply chain does need to provide for whatever it is that we intend to put on shelf. The challenges that we have in supply chain is that by and large, our suppliers are not as sophisticated. So if I'm going out to find unique products and genuine products made by artisan producers and that kind of thing, these are not massive, you know, high scale manufacturing businesses, almost by definition. And so being able, that means that often there's a lot more of them. So I can't go to Unilever and say, I'll take 500 different SKUs from you. I need to go to Mary and say, I'll take the three types of jam that you make. And so I'm dealing with a larger number of much smaller and less sophisticated suppliers by and large. And therefore, I have a challenge in trying to go and say, okay, guys, we want to map the carbon footprint of the entire organization. That includes the upstream carbon footprint, which is you guys. Come back to us. Now, if I go to Unilever, I can guarantee that the likes of Unilever and P&G and Mars and those guys, they're already thinking about this, and they've got big teams of people that are probably already starting to do that work. And Mary, who's producing three varieties of jam, is not thinking about that. And although they might be in a much better position from the get-go because they might be, as an individual, more concerned about it and less concerned about the profitability, more concerned about making sure that they're doing the right thing. So the difficulty is in trying to upskill a supply base that's not necessarily as sophisticated. So that's my specific challenge in the area. The other challenge then is who bears the cost? Does the supplier bear the cost? Does the retailer bear the cost? Does the consumer bear the cost? And, you know, the pricing of externalities is the big issue in carbon, and it doesn't go away when it comes to the food industry. I think food production, agriculture globally, and food production together accounts for something like 15 or 20% of total carbon emissions. So it's a big challenge that needs to be addressed. I think what we will see in the next couple of years is interesting and clever business models which allow those externalities to be priced in and allow consumers to either opt in or to opt out, or at least understand all the businesses that are in the supply chain to understand where those costs are and what needs to be done in order to address them.
You've been quite active in promoting something called regenerative agriculture. I wonder how you see that playing out in your industry.
Regenerative agriculture is phenomenal. There's a couple of, you know, world-class farmers in Australia taking some learnings from overseas and then adapting it to Australian conditions. And effectively, regenerative agriculture says that we need to work with nature instead of against it. So the industrial agriculture that we've all sort of become used to is taking the soil as kind of just a dead matrix in which we will add nitrogen, phosphorus and water and we'll try and grow these plants, but we'll control it 100%. And then, of course, when we get outbreaks of disease, we'll put a whole lot of various chemicals on top and keep disrupting the natural cycles that occur. Regenerative agriculture says, no, that's not the way to go. What we need to do is, you know, we've got these co-evolved systems, the soil system, the water system, etc. And if we run those together, they're self-reinforcing, and that makes for a very, very active, alive soil, which actually draws carbon into it. And so there is the possibility that agriculture can go from being sort of 16% of the carbon output of the world down to potentially even zero. if done very well, we're going to be able to produce some foods that are carbon positive. We're going to suck carbon out of the atmosphere to produce our food. Now, if we can get to that stage and there's, you know, products where you get a carbon credit every time you buy the food, that's where we're on a real winner. That's kind of like the imperfect pig scenario where everyone wins. You know, the farmer wins, the consumer wins, the environment wins. That's the aim. And so we look at that and go, wow, you know, perfect solution. We need to now get out to a lot of farmers, and it will start, as it already has, with smaller farmers who are more interested in the outcome of all the stakeholders than they are, you know, just the shareholder, because, you know, the bigger industrial farms often have shareholders, not, you know, family farmers. And so I think we'll see this bottom-up approach to regenerative agriculture, and then some of the big guys will jump on it because they'll realize that some of the farming methods will drive much greater returns into their outfit. So we wanted to create more pull-through. First of all, key the consumers up on it a bit, let them learn a little bit about what regenerative agriculture is about and promote its benefits, and have them demanding these products coming through. And it doesn't even need to be at a price premium. I mean, a lot of this stuff, some of it at first will need to be price premium, but a lot of this stuff is going to be actually just as cheap to produce because you're removing a whole lot of inputs, you know, chemical fertilizers, etc. And so we should be able to get down to the point where the food costs the same, and so people will demand that it's grown from regenerative agriculture, and that will that demand will create supply. At the moment, there's not enough supply and not enough demand, but we're trying to bridge that gap in both directions.
So have you got an example of a specific product that's regenerative agriculture, and how have you worked with that supplier to bring them into your stores?
There's a muesli product called Brook Farm. They bought an old dairy farm up outside of Byron Bay, planted a lot of macadamias, as a lot of people in that area did, and they found that bush rats were consuming something like 8% of their crop. So the rats climb up in the tree and nibble through the shell of the nut, eat the nut and drop the shell and move on. And so they were baiting for rats, and that was costing them plenty and couldn't get on top of it. And then they had small areas of subtropical rainforest left on the farm, and they started on this process of regeneration, and they've built out very large areas of regenerated subtropical rainforest, and they introduced owls onto the farm, and now the owls control the rats, and now they lose less than 1% of the total crop to rats and don't spend anything on rat bait. And so not only have you got less poisoning of all sorts of other animals, you know, and increasing the biodiversity on the farm, you've also got lower input costs and a higher yield. And that's exactly the kind of thing, those are the solutions that we need to be looking for, because now you've got all this subtropical rainforest pulling carbon out of the air at the same time as providing for a much better commercial solution on a farm.
That's a great example. The other thing that's going on, you've got these changes in consumer behavior, demanding more sustainability, that's great. But the other big driver in your industry is change in technology. How is technology changing your business?
We're experimenting in two ways. One is using computer vision and AI to understand customer behavior. And, you know, we look forward, we see what Amazon has done over in the States with their just walk out technology. So not needing a register. When you can do that, you can be a lot more definitive around what is selling and where it's selling from and stuff like that. And so you can start to shape your supply chain to provide a much better, a much more accurate level of product, and you'll have more tools at your disposal to be able to determine what you need to do to sell out product before it now becomes a problem. And again, you know, computer vision and AI together can start to map product movement in a store in a way that humans never could, and it'll take a long time to get there. But, you know, the potential of doing an instantaneous stock take just by hitting a button and your camera sort of measuring the width, depth and height of product on shelf, and know exactly that I've got, you know, 5.68 kilograms of potatoes sitting on the stack. That stuff is possible. And then demand prediction is the other area that we're investing quite a lot in AI. Currently, my buyers do a gut feel analysis kind of thing on the fly of, you know, that they look at their numbers from the day before and they understand where they were the week before. So I've sold, you know, 16 kilos yesterday of this specific product in this specific store. Tomorrow is Friday, not Thursday, so we sell a bit more on a Friday. It's raining, so I'll sell a little bit less, and et cetera. So you take all of these factors and they make an intuitive call about how much we're going to sell, and then they buy to stock the store at that. A computer is much better at doing that than a human is.
Tristan, the future of food, what do you think is around the corner?
In food, we're going to see a reversion to what food was. I think the future of food is going to look more like the past of food, which I'm quite excited about. I think we're going to see a better understanding of nutrition and what drives nutrition. We're going to understand more and more that the less manufactured a product is and the less artificial ingredients we put in them, the healthier we're going to be. I think we're probably going to see more and more personalization of nutrition as well. And when you put those two things together, people will be able to shop more specifically around the things that they're going to be able to eat that satisfy them completely and taste fantastic and keep them healthy. And I think that's going to be an outstanding outcome for our health system, if nothing else, but the health of our bodies. And so, you know, we often talk about, you know, if your grandmother didn't have it in her cupboard, then you probably shouldn't have it in yours. And I think we'll see more and more of that over time. And we'll look to do things that assist and take us down that path. And we'd hope that becomes, you know, something of a leadership position in the industry.
Thanks, Tristan, for joining us. It's been a great conversation.
Tristan's shared some fascinating insights on how the food industry is changing. He and the team at Harris Farm have embraced the shift toward ethical consumption and carved out a niche in the fiercely competitive retail landscape. It's not without its challenges, but there's plenty of food for thought in Tristan's approach. Next up, Natika Garg, Associate Professor at UNSW Business School. We asked Natika about the tension that exists between consumer emotion and purchasing behaviour. She says greater transparency, consumer education, and industry stakeholders with a bias for action is what's needed to ensure ethical consumption is not a trade-off between a person's principles versus cost. Here's what Natika had to say.
We are not rational creatures as human beings, and we are not rational as consumers. So what got me interested way back when I did my PhD, and that has continued, is how do emotions influence us? And in the last two decades, we have amassed a lot of information on how emotions, and not just positive, negative, but, you know, specific emotions like sadness, anger, pride, gratitude can have very different effects on consumers and their behavior. So when it comes to, let's say, do I want to donate to a cause, or do I want to buy this sustainable product, or do I want to eat more chocolate, which was one of my studies, emotions can actually make a difference. So my focus in my research is not only to understand these effects, but then how can different stakeholders like consumers, marketers, policymakers understand these to better outcomes for the consumer and therefore the society. There are several things that can drive ethical consumption. So from being more pro-social, more aware of environmental concerns, so having those pro-environmental motivations, or even information, which leads to this next issue of whether everyone has equal access to information and knowledge, especially in the domain of sustainable or ethical food practices. And the answer is, I don't think so. So there are two sides to this question. One is, does everyone have equal access to information? And the answer is probably not. But the second is, even if they did, would they have equal capacity or ability to process that information? And again, the answer is probably no. So with education, obviously, people's ability to process information, people's ability to search for information goes up. And so we definitely need that to happen. And the other side is that the policymakers, the industry has to make this information more accessible so that even at the individual level, these differences will always exist. Society is never going to be equal. But let's try and give everyone the opportunity to get this information and sort of work off it. Cost is a huge barrier when it comes to engaging in ethical, sustainable consumption, because as of today, ethical products, more sustainable products are more expensive. Right? Now, whether that is a little margin or a hugely great margin, it depends. So if you take even a simple example of eggs, eggs, they started with this free-range eggs, and at least those of us who were paying attention to this, I, for one, want to have free-range eggs, right? I'm not going to support animal cruelty or that industry. But then, as a consumer, you find out that, you know what, it might say free-range, but there are still 10,000 eggs per hectare. So you're like, what? That's not really free range. What are you doing? So I think there are two parts. One, the system is stacked against the consumer right now. You are asking the consumer to make a trade-off between their ethics and principles versus cost. That is obviously there. So why should I have to make a trade-off? So if I am struggling to put food on the table as an adult in a family, don't give me that choice. Don't put it on my shoulders that I either have to compromise my principles, even if I wanted to engage in ethical consumption. I have to pay so much more for it that I can't afford it because there are much cheaper alternatives. So don't give that trade-off. So it is a systemic issue which we have to fix. Now, food industry or even the government, I don't think anyone is doing enough to address this. But because the consumers are becoming slowly more aware and are demanding this, we are seeing sort of a pull system where the demand is driving innovations and the demand is driving supply. So because there is a demand, they are trying to find solutions for it.
So given the barriers consumers face when choosing to shop ethically, what are retailers doing to help people make more informed choices? And where does the responsibility lie when it comes to regulation?
So to motivate consumers to shop ethically, there are multiple things that the retailers are doing or the manufacturers are. So going back to that egg industry, which has probably been around for the longest time, I think, in terms of different product categories in the marketplace, there is a lot more information. Now, if you go to stores, they put how many hens are there per hectare. So not every cage-free egg is cage-free. So we know that now. So as consumers are building up that knowledge base, they are being more discerning. They are becoming connoisseurs of sorts in a category. And that's what's pushing the industry to come up with innovation. Policy is coming along, but I think for a lot of us who are aware of pro-environmental and ethical consumption is probably not at the pace at which we would like it to be, partly because policy always has to balance the greater good, what is going to happen for the maximum number of consumers in the society. And so right now, if you see, there's so much more focus still on the communicating just the nutritional value of processed foods, for example. So putting the stars on the front in Australia or giving a different sort of a light, green light, red light, yellow light, you know, in some other countries. One of the biggest challenges for policymakers is regulations around ethical consumption. Because again, we know marketers intentionally or unintentionally tend to misuse consumer concern. So what they'll do is, oh, this is natural. And now if I'm not very careful, I interpret natural as organic or as ethical. So there is a lot of research now on this that, you know, consumers do misinterpret because we have limited information processing resources. We have limited time. I don't have the time. I'm just going to take your word for it. If it's found out that marketers are not doing that properly, it can break the consumer trust. So policymakers are also involved, although they're always one step behind. They first figure out that it's been misused and then they figure out how to remedy it. Organic, for example, there was so much controversy over it because different countries had different regulations around what does it mean to be organic. And some had no regulation at all. So marketers just started saying natural and organic without it being actually sensibly, chemically organic. And I think that's the problem with ethical and sustainable consumption, that so much of the onus is on the consumer, whether it is to sift who's actually doing it right. Is it really ethical? Is it really sustainable? Or whether it is making that call that I am trading off my principles for money? You know, what if I don't have enough money to make that trade-off? Then I have that guilt. So I think the onus needs to shift from consumers to policymakers and the industries. They have to give the right options as well to consumers.
Thank you for joining us for The Business of Food. To find out more about today's episode, search for AGSM's The Business Of podcast online. Please share, rate and review, and subscribe to AGSM's business podcast on your favourite platform, and look out for future episodes. In the meantime, you can follow AGSM at UNSW Business School on LinkedIn and Facebook for more industry insights for an accelerating world. Until next time, thank you for listening.